Good morning. Welcome to Lexington Park Baptist Church. We're glad you've come to join us this morning. Would you please stand and join us as we kick off worship with Lion and the Lamb.
Seated. Want to welcome everyone here to Lexington Park Baptist Church, where God is on the move.
Hallelujah.
And hallelujah. So I hope you're keeping warm on this sunny, balmy day. Yeah, amen. Some of you love it and some of you are like, no. So I did turn the heat up, so if you get too hot, tough luck, all right? And if you're cold, just put your coat on. But anyway, it's good to see you all here today. 22 degrees officially today. Is that awesome or what? So that's reminding me of Ohio weather. Anyway, good to have. And then this week is going to be 65. Yeah, I know. Look, so what? Yeah, so Florida's coming up here now. So anyway, good to have everybody here today. Let's read the word of the Lord. On the front of your programs, it says, "Yours, Lord, is the greatest and the power and the glory and the splendor and the majesty. For everyone in the heavens and on earth belongs to you." 1 Chronicles 29:11. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for this day. We thank you that we can come to worship you. We thank you that you love us. We thank you that you've showed your mercy and grace towards us. We thank you that we can be gathered here together to show love towards one another. We thank you that we can lift our voices of praise to you. God, whatever we've come into this room with, whatever struggles we may have and burdens we may have, Lord, in these moments, may we cast those anxieties upon you and know that you care for us and that you're involved in our lives. And Lord, for this moment, may we just pause and find your rest and find your peace. And may we be in a good place here today. May we know that we're in your presence and we're right where we need to be. God, I ask you to speak to every heart and mind here today. I pray that you inhabit the praise of your people and that you'll be glorified in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Have some announcements. First thing is, if you're our guest today, there's a detachable portion of your program. If you can please take time to tear that off and fill that out between now and the end of the program and the service. There's a black box in the foyer by the staircase. Please put that there. Home folks, same thing for you. Anything you need to communicate to the church, any decisions you may need to make on the back of the card, or if you need to sign up for Wednesday night meals, please take time to fill that out. You can put that in any of the boxes, but the black box in the foyer is there. If you're our guest, there's also gift bags on the black table in the foyer. Please ask somebody or grab one. That's our gift to you today. Thank you for being here. So for everybody else, let's go through our announcements today. We have several things in your communicator. If you can get that out, please. And in your communicator, the first thing I want to say is that next week is picture day. So there's photo days coming up. And again, if your photographer, your photo is like outdated by 13, 15 years, like that one is right there on my family, you need a new photo. All right, even if it's like 5 years old, you need a new photo. So what we're going to do next week is there's going to be four of us. Each corner will have somebody with a cell phone taking pictures of you and your family. Come prepared for that. And we'll also do it the next week. So if it's too crowded this week and you're like, hey, I'll skip and come back next week, that's fine too. All right, veterans, you'll be in the foyer. So we want to get a picture of everyone that served our country or currently serving our country. There'll be a flag out in the foyer. Look for me. I'll be the one taking those pictures. So if you could please do that next week, we start that. And then we go also February 4th, we'll do that. Newcomers class, you need to sign up for. If you are new to our church, you have never gone through a newcomers class, or if you're a part, you're old timers here, but you've never gone and you would like to go through the class because you're like, I want to see what everybody new gets taught, then come to that February 11th, 18th, 25th, and March 3rd at 8:30 in the fellowship hall. So please come on out for that. Last week, Melissa gave an announcement on the women's conference, Revive. Make sure that you've signed up for that. See them in the foyer. They're still doing their thing out in the foyer today. Make sure you sign up for that and see her if you have any questions. Direction for discipleship in 2024. Where's Tim Hulls at? Where are you at? He's on duty. All right, so he's out in the foyer. So Tim Hulls is our new discipleship director. So I want to encourage you, there's a meeting for all teachers and leaders. So if you teach a small group, if you're over women's ministry or men's ministry, any of those areas where you're teaching, you're involved in discipleship, GAP, youth leaders, children, key leaders over children's ministry, we're having lunch provided after church on February 11th. You need to be here directly after church. Tim needs to give guidance on the new direction for the discipleship processes of our church. He has taken the ball and running with it. I'm excited. I'm having a hard, and this in my office, is they're not used to me saying this, I'm having a hard time keeping up with Tim. And I mean, they're like, now how does that feel, Pastor? Right? Yeah. So, it comes back around, right? So anyway, Tim is really hitting it hard, going at it. Also, graduates and professionals next week, Nicoletti's, the 28th at 6 p.m. We'll be meeting for pizza. So we'll be purchasing the pizza. You guys show up at 6 p.m. We're going to have like focus group time and do some discussion on things we'd like to see from the group. So please, if you're in that age 18 to upper 20s, right at 30, we're looking for you to show up for that. You can read the rest of the announcements on here, anything that's going on. Continue to pray for the search team and continue to be focused on the things going on. You can look at your weekly schedule. So with that, it's time for us to now greet one another. Please stand up and tell somebody you're glad to see them here today. Thank you. Okay, if I could have everyone please return to their seats. If it's good to be in the house of the Lord, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right, so today on our cooperative program in action, we're going to look at our missionary of the week from Dover, Delaware, not too far from us. Chaplain serving in the military, Matthew Knight. If you didn't know, we have the largest segment of chaplains in the military. They're commissioned by the Southern Baptist Convention, and they serve our nation wearing a uniform, serving our military personnel. So pray that God will strengthen Matthew and other chaplains who provide spiritual support for families that are in need, whether it's grieving families, whether it's marriage retreats, or whether it's ministering to the chain of command, or it's ministering to the sailor or the soldier or the airman or the marine down at the lowest level. Chaplains can make a difference in the lives of people in the military. So we want to be praying for our chaplains that we send out to serve our nation. So if you will please join me in praying for Matthew and other chaplains that serve our nation, please pray with me. Father God, we come to you in the name of Jesus, and we lift up those that serve you and serve our country. Lord, those that have got their you first, and they know that they've got to serve their country to reach the lost in our, for our service men and women. And Lord, I just pray that you bring the gospel to them, also be with them if they're in combat areas where they're trying to minister to those that are going through highly stressful scenarios and situations. And Lord, keep our chaplains safe and keep them focused as they try to minister to the men and women that are putting their lives on the line for each and every one of our freedoms. God, I pray for Matthew Knight specifically. Be with him as he ministers at Dover, Delaware, as he continues to serve and helps in the mental health profession there at Dover, as he's helping families that are grieving the loss of either a loved one or someone that's died in their command or with them, their partners. And Lord, we just pray that you be with him and give him words of wisdom and help him to help those that grieve and mourn, and that they might find you. We pray this in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Now it's time for our scripture reading for the day. Wayne Adams.
Morning, church. Today's scripture is Colossians chapter 2, verses 20 to 23. Since you died with Christ to the elemental spiritual forces of this world, why, as though you still belong to the world, do you submit to its rules? Do not handle, do not taste, do not touch. These rules, which have to do with things that are all destined to perish with use, are based on merely human commands and teachings. Such regulations indeed have an appearance of wisdom, with their self-imposed worship, their false humility, and their harsh treatment of the body, but they lack any value in restraining sensual indulgence. Pray with me. Lord, let us seek your wisdom and your ways, and not the ways of the world. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, would you please stand and join us as we continue worship, lifting up our glorious God with We Believe.
Time of desperation. clean hands and give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face. Oh God of Jacob. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face. Oh God of Jacob. Oh God of Jacob. Oh God of Jacob. Give us clean hands and give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands and give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your.
Save my soul, I am yours forevermore. I won't be moved of this, I'm sure. You are my God and you saved my
my soul.
Amen. Join me in prayer. Father God, we just praise you that we can come to you with excitement and joy, but also in the same thing, celebrating that you saved our souls, but also coming to you with clean hearts and pure hearts. And Lord, as that song tells us, may we not bow our soul or lift our soul to any other but you. So Father, in this place, may you have been glorified, and may you have received our praise worthy of the God that you are. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Tom's coming up for offertory. It's that time where we can give back to God. As God has given us everything through his Son, Jesus Christ, we get to be a part of that, participating with him in our givings and our tithes and offerings. So I want to encourage you, we have the two boxes up front, and we have the black box in the foyer by the staircase. You can give after church, or you can continue to mail in your check, or you can give online. And the same for all of our audience out there. Thank you for being generous givers, as always. Tom McCain, our chairman of deacons, going to lead us in scripture and prayer today.
This is out of the book of Nehemiah, chapter 13, 1 to 14. On that day, the book of Moses was read aloud in the hearing of the people, and there it was found written that no Ammonite or Moabite should ever be admitted into the assembly of God, because they had not met the Israelites with food and water, but had hired Balaam to call a curse down on them. Our God, however, turned this curse into a blessing. When the people heard this law, they excluded from Israel all who were of foreign descent. Before this, Eliashib the priest had been put in charge of the storerooms in the house of God. He was closely associated with Tobiah, and he had provided him a large room formerly used to store the grain offerings and incense and temple articles, and also the tithes of grain, new wine, and olive oil prescribed for the Levites, musicians, and gatekeepers, as well as the contributions for the priests. But while all this was going on, I was not in Jerusalem, for in the 32nd year of Artaxerxes, the king of Babylon, I had returned to the king. Sometime later, I asked his permission and came back to Jerusalem. Here I learned about the evil thing Eliashib had done in providing Tobiah a room in the courts of the house of God. I was greatly displeased and threw all Tobiah's household goods out of the room. I gave orders to purify the rooms, and then I put back into them the equipment of the house of God, with the grain offerings and the incense. I also learned that the portions assigned to the Levites had not been given to them, and that all the Levites and musicians responsible for the service had gone back to their own fields. So I rebuked the officials and asked them, "Why is the house of God neglected?" Then I called them together and stationed them at their posts. All Judah brought their tithes of grain, new wine, and olive oil into the storerooms. I put Shelemiah the priest, Zadok the scribe, and the Levite named Pedadiah in charge of the storerooms, and made Hanan, son of Zakur, son of Mataniah, their assistant, because they were considered trustworthy. They were made responsible for distributing the supplies to their fellow Levites. Remember me for this, O God, and do not blot out what I have so faithfully done for the house of my God and its services. Let's pray. Lord, help us to remember to keep holy what you have said is holy. Whether it's just ourselves or your church that you've given us to come to worship together in. Help us to remember to set apart the tithes, the offerings that we have for you, bring them in so that we can use them to your service. We thank you for this opportunity, Lord, and we thank you for this church to call home. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. O Lord, I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. You know me. You know when I sit and when I rise up. You know my thoughts, my going out, my lying down. You're familiar with all of my ways. Even before I speak, you know my words. You know my name.
I was going to say, Greg, I'm not going to sing that again, okay? So as we prepare our hearts, as the choir comes down, let's prepare our hearts for the Lord's Supper. If you did not get the elements, if you could raise your hand, and we have Randy and Tom in the back, they can pass them out. I see one over, a couple over here. And anyone else, so if you don't have that, preparing for the Lord's Supper, I want to read from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, starts in verse 23. It says, "For I received from the Lord what I also pass on to you. On the night in which he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, also he took the cup after supper, and he said, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" May God add a blessing to his holy word. As we prepare for the Lord's Supper, there's a few things. I know we have new people always in here too. We practice what's called an open table at Lexington Park Baptist Church. If you are a believer in Jesus Christ, you are welcome to this table, no matter what your background is. If you believe in Christ, we all will sit at the marriage table someday, so we might as well learn to sit together down here on earth. Amen? So if you want to come to the table, you are welcome today to join us as a family. This is really called a love feast. This is a place where love should happen. And so I want to remind you, Jesus was wanting to make sure through the words of Paul here that we be mindful that we love God and we love one another. That we be mindful that our hearts are right with God and with one another. So I want to give us, as we meditate here in a moment, make sure that you have that the clean hands and the pure heart and that you've not given yourself to another. Make sure that your heart is right with God in this moment before we take of the Lord's Supper, and remember what he's done for you, that he died for you, that he was buried for you, that he's raised from the dead for you. And when we take this, we remember his blood shed and we remember his body that was broken on our behalf for our benefit. So may we always be focused on that. Please pray with me, and then Daniel's going to play some music. Father God, we thank you we can come to your table today. What an awesome privilege you've given us. What a place of great humility, but also victory, where we can humble ourselves before you, reminding us constantly that you gave yourself for us. But Lord, we can also remember when we take of the bread and we take of the wine, Lord, that we know what you've done on our behalf. You have forgiven us. You've given us eternal life. You've given us a place in your kingdom. You've called us sons and daughters. And so, Lord, we thank you. We thank you for the victory of this table, and we thank you for the remembrance of this table. In Jesus' name. On the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread and he broke it. He said, "This is my body, broken for you, eat in remembrance of Christ." In the same way, he took the cup and he blessed it. And he said, "This is the blood of the new covenant that was shed for the remission of our sins. Drink in remembrance of Christ." Thank you, Jesus. We remember that you came in the flesh and dwelt among us, and you were broken for us, and you are the bread of life. Jesus, we thank you that you made a way for a new covenant, a new way, a way of grace, not a way of the law, a way to be made right with you. Through the shedding of your blood, we have the remission of our sins, and we are eternally grateful, and we do this in remembrance of you. And now, Jesus, if we have remembered, Lord, may we carry this with us now. May we be mindful of how we live our lives so that it reflects wholly upon the Savior that you are, the Redeemer that you are, the King that you are, and the Lord that you are to each and every one of us that is bowed in knee to you. We love you, Lord. It's in your name we pray. And all of God's people said, amen. Let's get our Bibles out. Let's raise the word of God high and say this with me. This is my Bible, God's holy word. I will make it a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path, and hide its words in my heart that I might not sin against God. Amen. God bless you. So listen, I have told the children's ministry that we're going to run long today. So I'm just preparing you. If you got kids up there, they're taken care of. They're prepared for it. All right? Because I have a lot I need to share to continue to prepare for the sermon series that's coming up over the next couple of months. I want to go back a little bit to the things that I said yesterday. First of all, this. You are a new wineskin or an old wineskin. That's a choice you must make. Just putting it straight out there, right? I mean, Jesus said it that way. I'm just saying his. So I hope that everyone in this room says, I want to be a new wineskin. I want new flowing into me. I want new coming out of me. I want Jesus. He's not done with me. Amen. All right? If you can't say that, you need to really do some time with the Lord. Do you want to be an old wineskin that's going to burst when God does something new or tries to do something new in your life? Or do you want to be this new wineskin that can bring in the new wine and can bring you to where Jesus wants you to be and he can use you? And so that's last week, many of you all said, I couldn't keep up with notes. People were writing that was the best sermon you've ever preached. I said, I don't know about that, but okay. It spoke, and I'm glad. So this week, I'm rehearsed, but I'm not rehearsed. I have some notes, but I really want the Spirit to flow. So if what I preach here today is what happened when I practiced Thursday, that's why I needed to prepare you. Sit back, buckle up, and I hope God's anointing is in this room like it was when it was just me and Jesus on Thursday. And I hope that it's well received again, as this is going to launch us into a discovery of what love is and how we're supposed to apply love and grace in context of things in a broken world. That's where we're going. By the way, if you didn't know, you live in a broken world. If you didn't know, look to the person next to you on your right. Go ahead. Look to the person to the left. They're broken. Now look up front. He's broken. And we live in a broken world. And that requires us to love and extend grace. Christians, we should be the best at doing grace and love. We should be the best at forgiving. We're not. Sometimes the world can be more loving and gracious and kind and forgiving than we are. So this is not to like step on toes, point fingers, or direct anything. This is just being pure Jesus with you. The greatest compliment that's ever been told to me, and I'm not saying this to brag, is, you know what? I need someone that loves Jesus, and you love Jesus. And I hope all of you know that. I love Jesus. And because I love Jesus, I love you. And so part of my job as a pastor is to educate and train and take us where God wants us to go. And when things happen and we see things in our culture and our world, you know, God's constantly working on me, and I'm like, okay, how can I preach on this or that? And so this sermon has been in my heart for a long time. Forgiven much, loves much. Much love, much forgiveness. If you have received much love, you should give much love. If you have received much forgiveness, you need to give much forgiveness. That's why I sign everything much love. If you ever get an email from me, I usually sign it with much love. Much love. I have received much love. More love than I ever deserve. I've received more forgiveness than I've ever deserved in my life. And here's the truth, so have you. The farther we get away from realizing that, the more we become like a Pharisee. And Jesus was harsh on the Pharisees. Why? They had forgotten their God. They had forgotten their first love. They have forgotten that God came to forgive and God came to have a relationship. And Christians, if we're not careful, we get so churched that we forget. Yet this table reminds us every time we take it, doesn't it? It should be a moment for us to remember the love and forgiveness that God has extended to us, and we need to extend to each other. So I want to challenge us today. I want to challenge us in this new year. How are you going to be more like Jesus? How are you going to be the new you that he wants you to be so that you can be the best you? You got to do that. I can help you. I can try to challenge us. I can try to point out things that we need to work on, and I'm going to. And one of the things is our heart. Will we love and will we forgive? And what's that mean? What's that mean? What's it mean to love and forgive? Listen, it's easy for us to love each other. It's easy for you to love someone that's family. It's easy for you, and that's not always true, but a lot of times it is. You know, I always tell my kids, they can get away with a lot more with me than you all can, because I'm going to love them no matter what. But isn't that how we should treat everybody? And shouldn't we truly love and forgive everyone in this room? So for a moment, I want to pause. This sermon is not for the people outside these walls. The world does not know Jesus. I want you to hear that. That's not giving them a pass. Sometimes we need to be hard on the world. Sometimes we need to, because they're destroying society or they're trying to bring ungodliness. I get it. We need to be strong, and I'm right there with you. I will do the March for Lives, and I'll do all those things, and I want you to come with me and join me. I'll be vocal on things that we need to be vocal on in our community and things like that. But for right now, this moment, this is about us. We are family. We are to love each other and forgive each other. When someone steps into this room, they're our guest. When someone steps into this room and they say, I need Jesus, we're right there with them. When someone steps into this room, no matter what their past is, and they have asked Jesus for forgiveness, and they have repented of their sin, they are forgiven. You need to forgive them too. And we need to love them. So, from this side to this side, we need to love. From this side to this side, we need to forgive. And we need to live in that love and that forgiveness like it really changes our lives. I think everyone in this room knows what I just said. You go, yeah, right on, Pastor. We need to love. Right on, we need to be forgiven. I'm forgiven and I love, man. I got it. Do we really? Because we're going to learn today that Simon thought he had it too. But only the woman from the town really got it. And you need to make a decision. Are you going to be Simon? Or are you going to be the woman of the town? We don't like that title, do we? It expresses probably some immorality. Probably makes us uncomfortable. What's it even mean, the woman in the town? What's it even mean? What was she a prostitute? Was she a stripper? Was she an adulterer? I mean, she's not married. She's living on the town. What's this even mean? These are people I don't want to associate with. And that's how she was viewed. But yet her heart was more pure than anyone else in that room except for Jesus. So today, as we look at this woman here in Luke chapter 7 here in a minute, I want to do some prelude to this. Where do you struggle to love and where do you struggle to forgive? Not asked. Well, you need to write it down. You back of your notes, flip that piece of paper over your bulletin and get ready to write. Because I'm going to ask a bunch of questions. Because there's a lot of things as Christians I know we struggle with. How can I forgive that? How can I look past that? How can I really believe that God says east to west and he really means that on that? How can that be? How could God really do that? Does he not know what this person did? Who do we sound like when we talk that way? Pharisees. Pretty clear in scriptures. But when we say your sins are forgiven, who do we sound like? Jesus. So I want to bring us to a point to where we live this out in our lives, and I want to give you a reminder of Christianity 101. Romans chapter 3, verse 23. All of you, if you're saved, you know the scripture. For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. All. Go ahead and say me. Me. All. Every single one of us in this room, that's us. Every single one of us has done this right here. It doesn't matter that you may think Dave's sin is really not that bad compared to Chris McCombs' sin. God does not look at it that way. Any sin falls short of the glory of God, no matter what you have done. Whether you're a goody-two-shoe almost your entire life, it's still not good enough for God. You still fall short of God's glory. Now look, I'm not here to beat you down. Here's the good news. God knew that, and he had a plan for it. All right, isn't that awesome? He didn't leave us in that point. And so if you're a Christian and you've come to Jesus and you've done the John 3:16 and you get it, I believe in Jesus, I have eternity security. And then what happens? Every single one of you, once you became a Christ follower, you're perfect, right? What? Wait a minute. Are you saved? Wait a minute. You mean you made a mistake after that? All right, what do we do? Basic 101. Guess what? 1 John 1:9 is written to believers. And by the way, precepts is studying John 1, 2, and 3 right now. 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, this is as believers, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and righteous and just to forgive us of all of our sins and to cleanse us from all of our unrighteousness. Now, he's already done that eternally, right? He's already saved you. But here's the deal. When you fall short now, doesn't mean your past haunts you again. Doesn't mean you go back to ground zero again. Doesn't mean, oh man, I'm done. I'm going to hell now. No. Go to Jesus. And this is true for you right here. You confess. This is what we do. This is how we're to live. So if anyone confesses their sins, and by the way, there's some scriptures say confess with our brothers and sisters. All right, if we confess our sins to God, he's going to forgive you. I acknowledge I'm wrong, God. I have messed up again. I keep doing it. I don't know why I keep saying this or doing that or going back to my vices. God, forgive me, help me, cleanse me, make me new again. And then you move forward. You fail forward. That's what a Christian does. Because of Christ, you can fail forward. So we're forgiven. Psalm 103:12, a very popular text. As far as the east is from the west, God has removed your transgressions. Now, this is really important. Can you go to the North Pole? So everybody say yes. Can you go to the South Pole? If I go as far south, I can get there, right? And then once I pass it, I'm going north, right? Can I go to the East Pole? Please everybody say no. All right? Can you go to the West Pole? No, because the more I go west, I have to keep going west. The more I go east, I just keep going east. There is no end to God's forgiveness. There is no sin that he will not cast to the east and to the west. We have to understand that. Murderers, east or west, if they're forgiven by Jesus. Drug addicts, east and west, if they're found in Jesus. Addicts, everything, abusers, yes, even people that are heinous in our eyes. If they come to Jesus, they are free. They're no longer known by that. Please tell me if you've been church long enough, every one of you can go back and go, I was taught that. And if you're not and you're new to church, I'm glad I'm laying that with you right now. But if you've been church long enough, I need you to go back to that day and remember that. Remember these basics where, thank God, God cast my sin from the east as to the west, and I'm not known for that anymore. And if I mess up, thank God I can come to him now and know he will still forgive me, love me. Listen, there's a statement that I love. One of the songs that I listen to is, God cannot love you any more, and he cannot love you any less. God cannot love you any more, and he cannot love you any less. If you're in Christ, you're his son or daughter. Let's make sure we live there as a people. May we be mindful of Jesus' model prayer. We know it, our Father who art in heaven. But you get down to the point where it says, forgive me my trespasses, I forgive those who trespass against me. Somehow, forgiveness also is connected, not just between me and Jesus, it's also horizontal. There are some things that are horizontal. Vertically forgiven, but horizontally forgiving as well. We need to live both of those things out in our life well. That, yeah, everybody wants to be forgiven. But do we want to forgive too? And when that means the same forgiveness that God gives us, east to west, we have to. Now, we're human. It's hard. I'm giving you the easy. I'm giving you the biblical answer. That doesn't mean it's easy. This is complicated. Because we're messed up. Right? People hurt. But 70 times 7, isn't that what Jesus said when Peter said, how many times do I need to forgive Jim Krennic for what he did to me? How many times? 70 times 7, if he comes back to you and says, I'm sorry that I kept doing that. And it's sincere, I do not have the right to withhold that forgiveness. Now, if Jim doesn't do that, then in my heart I need to still let it go. But it may not be forgiven until he makes that right. All right? So forgiveness is complicated. There's layers to it. There's parts to it. We have a part of confessing the sin. And when we do confess the sin and we do repent of the sin, the forgiveness comes. In us spiritually, but also it should amongst us too. And again, this doesn't mean, I want to give this caveat, that doesn't mean we keep returning to an abuser or something like that. There sometimes has to be boundaries. But there's still a level that I do forgive you, I just may not be able to be your best friend anymore. Or I do forgive you, but I can't put myself in this abusive situation again and again and again. So know that there are boundaries, so I'm giving you the biblical answer, but sometimes we need to use what I call biblical common sense. Okay? Jesus gave you a mind to use it to glorify him. But always, always, forgiveness is essential. So I want to be forgiven by God, don't you? And I want to forgive others that have hurt me the best that I possibly can. Yes? All right? And I don't want my past held against me. Therefore, I will not hold the past of others against them either. That's huge. That's huge. If you get that, that's huge. That's hard to do. So as Christians, I hope we can get to that level in our church where we can get to the point where we say, I'm going to just not love and forgive. I'm going to much love and much forgive. I know that might not be proper English, but it sounds good. Can I get to the point where I am forgiven much and I love much? Because that's Jesus. That's Jesus. And if you want to be like Jesus, you've got to do those things well. So I hope that you and I can do that. So let's go to the text now, and we're going to read about this unnamed woman. Her name does not matter. Some speculate who she is. And I won't do that in the purposes of this sermon. But we'll talk about this woman. We'll talk about Simon. We'll talk about the Pharisees. And we'll talk about Jesus. That are all in this story that Jesus gives us. So, Luke chapter 7. Let me get there. That'd be nice, right? All right, it says, then one of the Pharisees invited him to eat with him. He entered into the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. And the woman of town, who was a sinner, found that Jesus was reclining at the table in the Pharisee's house. She brought in an alabaster jar of perfume, and she stood behind him at his feet, weeping, and began to wash his feet with her tears. She wiped his feet with her hair, kissing them and anointing them with the perfume. When the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, "This man, if he were a prophet, would have known what kind of woman this is that's touching him. She's a sinner." Jesus replied, "Simon, I have something to say to you." He said, "Say it, teacher." "A creditor had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii and the other 50. Since they could not pay it back, he graciously forgave them both. So which of them will love him more?" Simon answered, "I suppose the one he forgave more." "You have judged correctly," he said. Turning to the woman, he then said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has, with her tears, has washed my feet and wiped them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but she hasn't stopped kissing my feet since I came in. You didn't anoint my head with olive oil, but she's anointed my feet with perfume. Therefore, I will tell you, her many sins have been forgiven. That's why she loved much. But the one who is forgiven little loves little." Then he said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." Those who were at the table with him began to say amongst themselves, "Who is this man who even forgives sins?" And then he said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." May God add a blessing to his holy word. This is, besides the adulterous woman, this is my second favorite text and scenario of Jesus in all of Scripture. I think the adulterous woman in this shows you the heart of Christ, the greatest. I think it also should reflect on us, because we're the adulterous woman and we're this woman. We are. You don't like that title given to you, do you? You're an adulterous woman. You're an adulterous person. You have been unfaithful to God. Stop in that for a minute. No one signs up for adultery. I know that. You're unfaithful to God. So have I been. I've committed adultery against God. I have not always been faithful to him. And all of us in this room can connect to that. Those two stories resonate with my heart because they remind me, even though I may not have physically done that deed, spiritually I have. And spiritually I'm in the same boat as them, and I need to be able to connect with them so I can understand the greatness of forgiveness and I can understand the love that Christ has for us. So as we look at this, there's three characters here. There's Jesus. Let's make clear we know who Jesus is, all right? He is the Son of God. He is the Son of Man. He is the God-man. He is the Messiah. He is the Savior. He is the Lord of Lords. He is the King of Kings. And he is there in the flesh, right there in this room, ready to teach a lesson both to Simon and this woman. And he's right there teaching us today. He wants us to learn the same lessons that they learned. Will we forgive like Jesus? Will we be like Jesus? Or will we be like Simon? Or will we be like this woman? Who will we be like today? The same lessons that he taught them over 2,000 years ago are the same lessons he's trying to teach the church 2,000 years later. Will we understand this Jesus? Because we all have a tendency to become like Simon. And that's the second character. Now look, I don't want Simon to get a bad rap. We're like Simon. Let's confess it. We have a tendency to be like Simon. We have a tendency to judge others. We have a tendency to complain. No, say never. We have a tendency to be critical. We have a tendency to label people. We have a tendency to hold pasts against people. We have a tendency to compare ourselves to others. Come on now. I see some heads shaking. Your righteousness is still not righteous to God. Only he is righteous. And so whatever the level is, it doesn't matter. Will we choose in this moment to be like Simon? Now, I have to be open here. Jesus is at Simon's house. This is a good thing. So Simon's probably like Nicodemus, if you've read your scriptures. There were some Pharisees that got Jesus. There were some Pharisees that were interested and intrigued by Christ. Simon's one of them. I give this guy a lot of credit. He's asking Jesus into his house. And Jesus has received this invite, which means he's probably not been calling Simon a brood of vipers. If you're around the scriptures, Jesus was hard. He was flipping tables. He was calling them all kinds. Jesus actually called them all kinds of names because of their Pharisaic legalism, right? Simon, at least Jesus sees something in him. Simon must be a little different. Simon's more open. And so Jesus is at his house with all of his household and his friends, which probably consist of other Pharisees as well. People that well-to-do, people that were well-to-do in that society, and they're in there, and here is Jesus. And Jesus is investing in them, hanging out with them, wanting them to get to know him. So there's something about him, but he also represents us. He represents the side of us that may not fully get Jesus yet. And listen, Christian, that may be you got Christ 30 years ago. Or like me in 1985. I want to remember 1985 so I never forget. I don't want to ever live like the man I was before 1985. And I don't want to ever forget what changed me in 1985. And I want 1985 to be just as pure and true for me today as it was then. And so should each of you. We should never forget that day of salvation, where the wretched man that I was, that God saved me. Not by my merits, not by anything that I did, but simply because God loved me and extended his grace and I received it. And you can too. Today, that may be you. Today, it might be the first time. Today, you may be Simon and saying, I need to get my act together. I have forgotten. I need to be right here with Jesus and learn this lesson. So Simon, not give him a bad rap, he can be us. The woman is us even though we don't want to be her. The woman is us even though we don't want to be here. Just this woman in the town, she is messed up, you guys. So what's she got going on in her life? I don't know. Maybe sexual immorality. What are the things we struggle with? Adultery, homosexuality, fornication, drunkards, divorce, liars, stealers, cheaters, attitudes. No teenagers ever had, right? Criticisms, complaining, unfaithfulness, ungratefulness, gossip, slander, legalism, judgmentalism, abandonment, betrayal. Whew. Failed parenting, financial failures, bad decisions, addictions of all sorts, abortion. Strippers, prostitutes, backsliders, forsaking the church, the list goes on and on. I bet something I just said, you have trouble forgiving or letting go. Maybe some of you are some of those things I just listed. Where you feel like a failure, but you also hold it against other people when they do it because you think you're better than them now. Come on now. I just said something strong. If we can't forgive people that do those things, we've got the problem, not them. And if we can't love them like Jesus did, then something's wrong with our love. And if we're not willing to forgive them when they come into this house, and if any of these people that I just, and the list could have gone on, right? But I guarantee you, some of those I just listed there, you have trouble forgiving people over. Let me tell you my weakness. I don't like people that abandon me and betray me. It hurts. And if you're going to be a pastor, it happens. If you didn't know that, you may love me now. You may not love me 3 years from now. You may not love me right now because of what I'm preaching. It's a constant ebb and flow. Let me tell you, I've seen schizophrenic Christians in church. One moment they're your best friend, the next minute they're backstabbing you. So it's hard for me to forgive those people. I'm confessing that. What's your weakness? What's that thing you can't let go of? What's that thing? I'm better than that. What's that thing you can't forgive somebody, even if they ask for forgiveness, because what they did is just so vile, I don't want anything to do with them. That's the woman. That's us. So verse 36 and 37, get right there. There's an invite that's given. Jesus is invited to Simon's for dinner with other Pharisees, and the woman will show up uninvited. I love her courage. She knows what she's stepping into, man. She knows she is not welcome. She knows the Pharisees hate her, but she believes that Jesus has forgiven her and loves her. She believes the story she's heard about this man, so she wants to come be with him. Let me tell you what. The woman shows up uninvited to this dinner party, and I have a story I want to share with you that really happened in my life, my first church. There was a woman named Shirley. She's a little black woman. She had no teeth. She smelled like cigarette smokes. And she would just walk the streets. She lived in a tin hut that had dirt floors. And I lived in plantation country where black and white didn't mix. And where the black people still worshiped on plantation churches, and the white churches only had white churches in town. This was 2000 to 2003, you all, not long ago. So being the man that I am, I ran into Shirley on the street. I invited her to church. And she goes, "Can I really come?" I said, "Yeah, you can come." I didn't know what I was getting myself into. That one decision would change my ministry forever. Shawnetta would almost think she had a heart attack. She went to the hospital in an ambulance. We did not know if someone would throw a brick through our window and if it would be a white person or a black person. We were hated by the community because I actually invited a black woman to church. And she came every Sunday. And she would sit in the back. She would be loved on by me and Shawnetta. Listen, she'd give me hair tonic for gifts. She'd give me do-rags for gifts. I couldn't tell her, you know, I don't need those things. She'd give me Aqua Velva. You remember that? Shawnetta, you remember those? She'd give me all these gifts. Listen, she had dirt floors and she was giving her pastor gifts. And was so grateful to just worship and be accepted. I don't know if I reached anybody else in that community, but I reached Shirley. And Shirley changed me too. I'll never be the same because of that. Because it changed me. This changed this woman. This experience can change you. When you come to Jesus and you truly don't care what others think, but just loving and forgiving. That's a good place to be. Simon may not like you. The Pharisees may not like you. But Jesus will love you. Amen? Even though you're not invited, remember the importance of the invite to invite people that may not be acceptable, that may be different, that maybe their past is shady. God's still got a future for them too. And he's still got a future for you. Verses 37 through 38, the intention. Now look right here when you look at this text. She comes in, she has no water, she has no towel, she has no oil, she doesn't have the right to kiss Jesus on his cheek, being the status that she was. But she comes in with none of those things, and she doesn't let it keep her from worshiping God. She comes in with her own tears, her own hair, her own kiss of his feet, which was considered disgusting in that day. Probably still is to us too, I get it. And she had an alabaster box filled with perfume that was probably highly valuable. And she would pour and anoint him with that perfume. She brought everything she had to Jesus that day because Jesus had loved her and forgiven her. Our job is to do the same. When you walked through these doors today, did you bring everything? Did you bring your tears? Did you bring your hair or lack of hair? I know. Spoken in love. Did you bring your perfume? Did you bring your kiss, willing to kiss the feet of Jesus? I admit, I don't always walk in the door with that attitude. I should. And maybe even though you're here to worship, maybe this should be humbling to us. I need to be like this woman in worship. I am here at the feet of Jesus, and I am grateful for his forgiveness and his love, and I'm going to sing my songs of praise to him. I'm going to anoint, even if you can't sing, it's going to be a pleasing aroma into his ears, his nose, and he's going to see me for who I am, and that I love him. My tears and my hair and my kiss and my perfume. Whatever those symbolically are for you today, God calls us to be intentional about what we do. She gave all, we give all. Verses 39 through 43, there's a powerful lesson here that Jesus is teaching about forgiveness and love. Jesus taught Simon and the others about love and forgiveness through a parable about 500 denarii versus 50 denarii. Who would be forgiven more would love much, would love more. Whoever's been loved that much or forgiven that much, they're going to have more gratitude back. Simon got it right. He saw what Jesus was saying, and he figured it out. Listen, the person that's been got the most in their past, that person understands this the most. Doesn't mean you can't get it if you're somewhere in between or if you've been pretty good all your life. You need to get it. And that's what Jesus is trying to teach here. But yeah, obviously, this woman who has much sin and has been forgiven of much, she's going to be more grateful. She's going to come and fully gets Jesus. But all of us should fully get Jesus. Because remember Romans 3:23, we're all sinners. This is hard for some of us. It was hard for Simon, but Simon says, and the direct quote is, "I suppose the one who forgave more, he was right." The one who forgave more is the one that would love more. Forgiveness of Christ should lead us to love him and others more. Not less, but more. Now let's look at the Pharisee versus the woman in verses 44 through 47. I don't want you to miss this part, because if we're like Simon, we've got to fix this. I'm going to say that again. If we're like Simon, we have to fix this. What does Simon do? Simon invited Jesus. Simon's got the lamb roasting. They're ready to eat, man. They're going to have a party. They're going to have a good time. Jesus is here. He's going to hang out with me and my buddies and the Pharisees, and we're going to learn all about what Jesus has been teaching, and we're going to get to ask him questions. It's going to be a good day. But then as Jesus came into his house, which was custom, he didn't wash Jesus' feet. When Jesus came into his house, Simon forgot to greet him with a kiss. And when he got down to it, Simon never anointed him with oil. So Simon failed to do all of these things. And Jesus points it out. He's not being mean. He's like, hey, I've been in your house this whole time, and you've done none of those three things. But this woman, from the moment she got here, she came behind me, stood behind me, then kneeled down. She's been kissing my feet. She's been crying on my feet. She's been wiping my feet with her hair, and she poured her most expensive perfume on my feet. And you've done nothing. Whew. I don't know what Simon felt like, but probably a heel right there, right? You would think so, but no, his judgment's not over yet. So Jesus, knowing his heart, knowing that he messed up, he's not there to condemn him. He's just pointing these things out, and he's pointing out what this woman has done that we should do. And then when it gets down to it, the ending is the most powerful part. Not just this comparison of a Pharisee and a woman comparing ourselves. Are we like Simon or this woman? I want to be like this woman. Every week I want to be like this woman. I don't want to forget to kiss Jesus. I don't want to forget to wash his feet. I don't want to forget to anoint him with oil. Nor should you. And to do that, then we need to be willing to be like this woman, to fall at his feet. And so when he looks at the woman in verses 48 and 50, three things happen here. One, she's forgiven. Two, she's saved. And three, she's totally restored. They're like, Chris, where do you get that? Thank you for asking. We're going to look at these three verses so you fully understand them. This is how we treat people right now. 101 right here. Jesus looks at her and says, your sins are forgiven. Her sins were great, you all. Her sins were great. But Jesus says, you are forgiven. Now here's where Simon and the Pharisees come out again. They're like, who is this guy? Who is this guy that can say she's forgiven? Who in the world is this that could do that? First of all, Jesus is God. He has every right to do it. All right? But Jesus is forgiving her of her sins, which is a powerful statement, because they were unwilling to do it. Simon could not go there yet. I have to believe in my heart we'll see Simon in heaven, and I think he got it. I hope this event with Jesus changed his life. Because I have to believe he's changed my life. Because I've been a Simon before. You have too, probably. It's all right to confess that. I think Simon got it. But Jesus had to say, not only have I forgiven her, look what he does. And this will blow you Calvinists out of the water here. He says, your faith has saved you. Your faith. This woman had so much faith in Jesus, It brought salvation. Now, we know Jesus died. We know that Jesus did the work. We know that Jesus was the one that forgave her. But because she had faith, that brought salvation to her. Not only was she forgiven, she was now right with God. They did not like that. But the last part is the most important part. Because as we're going to move ahead into things, we're going to look at some of these things that people, we may put our nose up at, or we may say, no, how can that be? How can we forgive that? How can that person be saved? How can that be? Listen to what he does to this woman. This woman is clearly a sinner. This woman is clearly someone that society feels is not worthy of God. This woman is clearly an outcast. And this is what Jesus says. Not only has your faith saved you, go in peace. He puts his shalom on her. What's this mean? Her reputation is restored. She is no longer the woman in the town. She is no longer known by her sin. She is free. Jesus sent her out of that room on equal status with anyone and everyone, regardless of her past. Do you all understand that? This is huge. I challenge, go look it up. Go look shalom up. Go look at the peace. Go look at what it means to say all is well with you. He restored her completely. Now you think, well, wait. How can that happen? Let's go back and look at some examples of this. The woman at the well. She's a bad chick. She was. Jesus restored her. Let's look at the adulterous woman. Jesus restored her. Let's look at the woman in the blood disease who had the courage to touch. Your faith has made you whole. Let's look at the lepers, the stories of lepers. Your faith has made you whole. Go present yourself to the priest. They were whole. He changed them completely, no longer a leper, but made clean. Let's look at the thief on the cross. Today you'll be with me in paradise. Jesus did not hold his entire life against him, but in that moment, that man was set free. Amen? Example, the blind man born at birth. He made him whole. Over and over and over and over again. The demoniac, God delivered from demons, the legions, over and over. What God did was, you once were that, you are now this. Now, what is that this? Thank you for asking. If you have been forgiven and you have been saved, you are redeemed. We are not who we were, and we have not arrived to who we will be. Think on that one for a minute. You still have not arrived, no matter who you are, nor have I. But we're no longer who we once were. Because now we're known by a different title. We're now known something different. Who are we known as? We're children of God. All this is scripture, and if you want the scriptures, I can give them to you. I'm going to fly through this right now. You are a child of God. You are a new creation in Christ. You are now the beloved of God. You are now the redeemed of God. You are now a chosen race. You are a royal priesthood. You are a holy nation. You are the workmanship of Jesus Christ. You are heirs of Christ in all things. You're an ambassador of Christ, and you are more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus. Man, you should be clapping. That is you and me. That is every single one of us that comes. When we become redeemed, all those things are true. Not some of those things are true. That is who we are. Why do we as church folks struggle with that? Why can't we get that? Listen, if there's a 2x4, let Jesus pick it up and smack you over the head right now. God, don't ever let me forget that's who I am, and that's who pastor is, and that's who the person on the other side of the room is. That's every single one of us. Now, some of you may remain like Simon. I can't fix that. Only you can. I've got to fix the Simon in me. And when Simon comes up in me, I want to kill that guy. I want to die to myself to live more like Jesus. I'm just being real and humble with you. When I get frustrated or I get aggravated or this or that, or I start having a bad day, I don't like that man. I don't want to be that man. I want to be this woman. And no, I'm not confused over my gender. I want to be like her. I want to be found at the feet of Jesus with my tears, with my hair, with my kiss, and with my perfume. In a lot of ways, she reminds me of the Magi. She came bringing gifts, fit for a king. That's what Jesus wants out of you and me. So if we're going to be who we need to be, we need to remember to forgive much and love much. We need to remember that God has loved us much in Christ Jesus because he died for us. And we need to remember his forgiveness and how great that is. It changes. It should change you. It should constantly change us. So as we leave this today, I want you to know, if you're in here today, your past does not have to define you. There's a song that I like. It says, "You are not a sum of your past mistakes. People may hold them against you. I will not. And if I ever have, I want you to hear this. This is as humble as I can be. Please forgive me. If I have ever been in my whole ministry, if I have been judgmental in a way that was not of Christ, I beg those people, forgive me. If I was ever too harsh on you, forgive me. If I have ever put too much of an expectation on you, please forgive me. If I have ever tried to live up and make you live up to be a Simon, please forgive me. And if I've ever taught like a Simon, please forgive me. Because I want to be like Jesus." And I pray the same for you. So today, what's this altar call for? It's for you. Some of you may need to come up and cry. You can leave your perfumes in your purses, ladies, but symbolically, bring your perfume up. Or in my case, bring my Aqua Velva up. That Aqua Velva changed me. I have to confess, I don't wear it though. But whatever it might be that you need to come and lay at the feet of Jesus, whatever part of your Simon that's in your heart, can you get rid of it today? Can you learn from Jesus? And then whatever you need to do to show much love and much forgiveness, will you do it? And if you need to receive God's love and his forgiveness, that's what today is for. Today is for us to do those things with Christ. I can't say what it is you struggle with, but if one of those things I listed you struggle with, forgiving other people, I encourage you to forgive. Let it go today. If someone has hurt you and they've asked for forgiveness, forgive them today. Today. Did I say tomorrow? No, today. Let's make it more clear. Right now. And if you're in this room and you don't know Christ, today's your day of salvation. But don't leave this room. Don't leave this room unless you hear Jesus say the words he said to that woman. You are forgiven. Your faith has saved you. Now go in peace. All three things are yours for today if you'll receive Christ. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for loving us much, and thank you for forgiving us much in Christ. Jesus, today may we receive that forgiveness and love, and may it truly change us. I know that things like this take time to marinate and absorb and really change and penetrate hearts. So I reflected back on my life over this last week, really looking at areas in my life that I've had to change. I thank you for your grace and mercy and patience with me. Lord, continue to make me more like this woman. May I lay everything at your feet, and I pray for the people in this room. Teach us to do that. Teach us to live out of those identities. Not the identities of our past, but the identities of our present. Help us more understand we're a son and daughter of Christ. Help us understand we're heirs. Help us understand we're ambassadors and we're conquerors and we're redeemed and we're the beloved of you. And let us embrace those things so that we can leave today with your peace, your salvation, and your forgiveness. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand and sing, "You Come As the Lord Leads." Shared and God's moving in hearts and lives to change people. I hope He's done it to you too. If you need to step forward and come up here, there's something powerful. Be like that woman. Imagine if she never entered that building that day. She would have missed it all. So if God's speaking to you, I want you to come forward. I want you to come for salvation. I want you to come for that forgiveness. I want you to come to say, "God, I'm going to be like that woman." So if you need to confess, camera on me, heads down. If you need to confess of being like Simon, raise your hand. Submit it to God. Hands down. If you need to confess, you need to be more like that woman, raise your hand. Father God, you've seen the intentions of hearts today. You've seen those that responded at least with a hand raised to you to heaven. Lord, may you receive those things the same you received this woman. May you make those that have made these decisions today to be able to leave here today knowing they're forgiven, knowing that their faith has made them saved, and knowing that they can walk in your peace. They can be made right with you. And then, Lord, teach us how to treat one another that same way. So, Father, as we close, one more verse. If no one comes, we'll close. God, you move hearts and minds. In Jesus' name, amen. Blessed. My blessing is going to be a little different today. I'm going to end you with the blessing that Jesus gave that lady here in just a moment, reminding you that we have normal activity tonight. Impact 5 o'clock, Gap 5 o'clock, here, everything here, and I think that's all that's going on this evening. So if you have those, be there. I want you to have a blessed day. Now, may the Lord God make his forgiveness known unto you. May the Lord God make sure that you know that your faith has made you saved. And may the Lord God let you go in peace if you made right with him and your fellow man. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you guys.